Good morning. Good to see everyone here today. Beautiful Sunday morning once again, the end of September. A special welcome to our visitors here this morning for Grayson's baptism. It's an exciting day. So welcome to the family and friends who are here. We have a lot of our own missing, as you, I think, most know. This is Power Show weekend, so takes a lot of volunteers to make that happen, and we have a lot of our people out there this morning to make that happen. But we are here, and the Lord is here by the power and presence of His Spirit, and that's what matters. So just a few announcements before we go on with the service. Talking about the Power Show, our high school youth group has a food stand up there, so if you're heading out that way, want to have lunch, they're in one of the buildings, the vendor building, I suppose it's called, and selling chislik or burgers, hot dogs, karma rolls, kuchen, kolaches, that's the other one. Yes, it's all very delicious. So that's what's happening out there. A couple things to the congregation, our members here, if you did not get your Salem Spire for October when you came in, try to remember to pick that up on your way out there in the narthex on the table there. Also, there's a giveaway table in the social hall against this south wall of various items, two tables, two little tables, so take a look at that. The one other thing I'm going to mention is, again, to the congregation here, for the bulletin board in the social hall. If you like to do bulletin boards, we need somebody to do October's. Also, we need somebody in October who's willing to put the flowers out and put them back on Sunday mornings. So There's sign-up sheet for both of those things on the information cabinet out there. There's a lot of other announcements to read that I'll ask you to do later as you have time. But let's bow our heads in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we worship and praise you, Lord God, for your creation. This, the heavens and the earth, the universe, we as your people, how incredible, Father, that you would desire to have a relationship with us, a personal, intimate relationship. As your word says, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we could be called the children of God. It is truly incredible, and we thank you for it. And we are here because we love you with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our strength. And we desire to praise you as Lord of all, as King of kings and Lord of lords. Jesus, we bow our hearts and our heads and our lives before you. You are the one who reigns forever and ever. And this is your world that you created, and it is beautiful. Thank you for placing us here to live upon it and to spread the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So, Father, we ask that you would be magnified and exalted today here in all that happens, and we ask for your wonderful presence to fill this place, that your glory would fill this place, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Our opening hymn will be number 143 in the hymnal. It will also be on the screen. Let's stand together as we sing this. This is my Father's world. It is his world. Well, take a moment, greet those around you, please, before you're seated. Good morning, good morning. Hi, Laura, how are you? Good morning, Bella. Bridget. You can sit down. We'll have our sharing of joys and concerns here this morning. So some things I have first here, certainly, again, Grayson's baptism that we're excited for, and the family that's here, again, a welcome to all of you. Some other things, prayers for Linda Zabe. She's scheduled for knee replacement, not tomorrow, but the next Monday. So we'll be praying for her. Also for Lee and Pat Palmerville. Lee, last Sunday afternoon, had fallen at home, broke his hip. He had surgery on Tuesday and then spent most of the week in the hospital at Yankton, but did get to go home Friday afternoon. But it's pretty slow going there. He has had a lot of struggles before this, so it's different than most hip surgeries would be. Also, for the family of Leland Wiedmeyer, Leland and Clara May, he had come home last Sunday, after having four stents put in a week ago Friday, came home Sunday, was airlifted back to the Heart Hospital on Tuesday, where they put in two more stents, and then things just went downhill from there. There was a tear in his heart, and he went home to heaven last night about 11:30. So I don't know anything of the funeral arrangements at this time, but prayers for Clara May, a very dear family. Leland's the one that this little sketch here of Jesus above the church, make Christ known. He had a dream one night, this whatever years back, and he came to me and said, Pastor Mike, I had a dream, and I saw Jesus above the church with his arms out, open it, and I wonder if we could find something to put on the bulletin like that. Pretty neat, huh? So be praying for the family. That's pretty much the things that I had. So anything else over here? Okay, how about this side? Yes, Katie Huber. Lexi McNinch and Callie Huber both had birthdays last week. Happy birthday to you both. Awesome. Is that Cindy's hand? Okay. Ashlyn Fergan's birthday was yesterday. Happy birthday to you, Ashlyn. Okay. All right. Well, let's bow our heads in prayer then. Heavenly Father, we do come before you and we thank you for these birthdays that were mentioned. It's always an exciting time, and we thank you for each one of these individuals and the blessing that they are to their families and to all of us who know them. Lord, we want to pray for Clara May Wiedmeyer and the family, Cheryl and Daryl and the grandchildren. We just lift them up, Lord. You know for them it's been an emotional roller coaster of a week, with up and down and hopes up and then down, and certainly last night Leland's homegoing, which we know your word tells us is better by far, and we know it is, and we thank you that he knew you so well and that he's there with you now in heaven. But for the family and us as friends and congregation, it's a grieving also. So we ask for your comfort to all of them through this time. We pray for Lee and Pat Palmerville. They've had a lot of health issues lately too. Especially we pray for Lee now coming through this hip replacement surgery. Father, he needs your strength to get going back on his feet. And Pat does too as his caregiver. We just pray strength to them in every way, Father, spirit, soul, and body. For upcoming surgery, Linda Zabe with her knee replacement coming in a week. We thank you for going before her in that, watching over her through it, and we trust you for that, that you will be with the doctor and surgeon as they do this procedure. Thank you, Lord, for... I want to lift up Jessica Schaefer and Jennifer Byerly, two young mothers in our region right here. Both have young children. Both of these mothers are fighting cancer, serious cancer. We lift them and their families up to you, Father, in a very difficult time. trying to juggle life just in general. And yet, in the midst of this battle, we pray for them. We ask, Lord Jesus, for your healing touch throughout their bodies. Give them strength through this journey. Surround them with your peace and let their eyes and minds be fixed upon you, we do pray. Lord, we thank you for our healthcare workers again in the midst of a difficult time and season. For our military, we pray for them. We ask for strength, Lord, and wisdom through all this time. Lord, in our nation, you know better than we that things are so tense in all of this. Lord, so much doesn't make sense, but you do. For you never change, Jesus. Your word says you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so we rest on you in the midst of the craziness of the world around us, this world system around us. You remain faithful, and we thank you. So be with our troops, watch over them, keep them safe, Lord, wherever they serve, around the world or here within our nation. We thank you, and we pray for the harvest as we're full into it right now. Thank you for the conditions, Lord, that you've given to make it, to help it, help make it easier to bring it in, Lord Jesus. And thank you for what it is. In the midst of a big drought season, it's amazing what actually is out there. We thank you for all these things, and we love you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We have the offering box in back. We don't pass the plates, as you know, or the congregation knows. As my wife said so elegantly on Sunday school kickoff, it gives me 5 more minutes to talk. So, for you that are visiting, sorry, you don't know that story, and I'm not going into it. But I want to read from Psalm 62, verses 1 and 2. It says, "My soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I shall never be shaken." So let's stand and we'll sing the doxology, please, if you'd stand. Father, we do thank you for your blessings that are so incredible in so many ways. Even if we think we might not have much, but Lord, compared to other countries in our world, we are incredibly blessed. And we thank you for that. Father, help us not to hoard it upon ourselves, but we give cheerfully for the work of your kingdom, so that the gospel of Jesus Christ can continue to be spread throughout this region, nation, and far beyond, that all who live can know that Jesus, you are Lord of all, Lord of heaven and earth. So thank you for blessing our gifts, our offerings, and our tithes today in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray together the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. May be seated. At this time, we're going to have Grayson's baptism. So if Kaylee, if you and Ty want to come and with the sponsors, Bridget and Laura and Sydney and Ethan, if you come up here, please. Kaylee, you can stand here close to me, and Ty, you can be beside her. You guys can stand sort of over there, if that's all right. Yep. Thank you. Here's Grayson. Yeah. He's, what is he, 6 months? Yeah, almost 6 months old, right? So we're excited to have the baptism today. I just want to say, first of all, Kaylee, thank you for choosing life. God bless you for that. And for Ty for being here too, and Bridget Faith and Laura Fisher, and these are Ty's, two of Ty's brothers, Ethan and Sydney, so as the sponsors. I want to read first of all from Mark chapter 10, verses 13 through 16. It says this, people were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them. But the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. Why do you think the disciples rebuked him? They probably thought, oh, he doesn't have time for these little kids. He doesn't have time for this. And Jesus was like, no, well, I have time. They are very important. So he said to them, let the little children come unto me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. And he took the children in his arms, put his hands on them, and blessed them. Amen. So I have questions for, these are vows. I've, of course, met with Kaylee and Ty both, and we've gone over these vows as promises that they are making before God on Grayson's behalf. So I will ask them to you this morning. And the sponsors, you can also respond with a we do when I tell you, because you're a part of this as well. Okay? Do you desire to have your child baptized today? And do you understand that through this sacrament of baptism that we are actually dedicating Grayson unto the Lord? If so, answer, we do. Thank you. The word reason the word dedicating is in there is just so we know this is not his salvation, because he's not going to remember this day. There'll be a time where he has to receive Christ as his Lord and Savior as he grows. Second, will you instruct and encourage this child to renounce the powers of evil? And will you teach him the word of God so that he may be led to profess Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior? If so, answer, we do. Thank you. Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best you are able? If so, answer, we do. And fourth, do you promise according to the grace given you to grow with this child in the Christian faith, to help this child to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ by celebrating Christ's presence, by furthering his mission in all the world, and by offering the nurture of the Christian church so that he may affirm his baptism? If so, answer, we do. Thank you. There should be something coming on the screen here. I'll read the first part, and if the congregation will respond. The Bible instructs us to diligently teach God's word to our children. Do you who witness and celebrate this sacrament promise your love and care to this precious child about to be dedicated to the Lord through baptism as he grows in his knowledge of Christ? We promise our love, support, and care to Grayson James McCoy and to his parents. We will do our part in making sure that this will be a church where he can be trained in God's word and in his ways. Thank you. And Mark Guthmiller is our Christian Education Committee chairman. He's going to read a pledge from that committee.
As a representative of the Christian Education Committee, we pledge to provide an environment within this local church where Grayson can be taught the Word of God, where he can grow up spiritually, and where he can begin to develop a personal and intimate relationship with God as his Heavenly Father and Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. We would like to present Grayson and his family with his baptism candle as a remembrance of this special day. We also have a little children's first Bible to give to Grayson in hopes that his love for God's word will begin at an early age.
Thank you, Mark. Okay, Kaylee's going to hold him because I don't know that I'm going to balance him with one arm here today. Yeah, hey. So Grayson James McCoy, as we are here to dedicate you unto the Lord through this sacrament of water baptism, I now baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit of God. Amen. Yeah, where's that coming from, huh? Amen. I'll take him now, okay? Hey, bud. Hi. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do worship you and praise you. Thank you for Grayson, this gift of life to Kaylee and her family, to Ty and his family, Lord Jesus. We thank you for knitting him together within his mother's womb, Lord. You are amazing, and he is too. He is fearfully and wonderfully made in your very own image. So we lift him up to you in thanksgiving and praise for your goodness. In thanksgiving, Father, to you for your mercies, to these standing up here, your incredible mercy and your grace. So, Lord, for the parents, I pray, and the sponsors and the grandparents, that you guide them and direct them, that you give them wisdom to bring Grayson up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. Each and every day, thank you for a strong little healthy boy here this morning. May he continue to grow and develop according to your will and your plan and your purpose for his life. And I ask, Lord, that you give your angels charge over them and him to guard and keep them in all of their ways. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, I'm going to bring him down, and you get to sing to him, Jesus Loves You, okay? Go ahead. Thank you. You can go back to your seats. Thank you. Whew, had my workout this morning. If the children want to come, please, for the Kingdom Kids time.
Nice belt buckle. I like it. Did you win it? Did you win it? Your belt buckle. Great. Wow. Good morning, boys and girls. Hi. Can you say hi? Good morning. There's some seats over here. You can just sit on right up there on the floor, too. Okay? It's good to see you all. So, did any of you get to spend time with God last week, like we talked about? Yeah, I see some people saying, yeah, that's awesome. Well, I got a question, or not kind of a question, kind of a statement. Well, it's kind of a question, I guess. Did you know that God knows everything? You know that? I mean, not just like some things. I mean, everything. Did you know that? Yeah, he does. So raise your hand if you go to school. All of you all go to school, right? Most of you do. So do you know that your teachers, they know a lot of stuff. They know all about math and how to teach it, and about social studies and how to teach that. They know a lot of stuff. What else do they know? What else do you get taught? Reading, spelling. How about when you go to music? What does that teacher know about? Music and teaching you how to sing and science. Your teacher knows about science. PE, they know how to help you to get physically strong. So your teachers know a lot of stuff about what they do, right? But do you think they know everything? No. Who knows everything? Only God knows everything. And God knows everything about everything. He knows everything about everything. I know, it's kind of crazy, isn't it? And it tells us in the Bible about this. Did you know that God knows how many hairs are on your head? Yeah. Do you know that?
One.
Yeah, probably millions. And when you lose one, he knows it. Did you know that? Do you know that God knows every star in the universe?
Yeah.
Every star, every single star and planet. Did you know that God knows every creature and animal that crawls on the earth and under the earth and in the sky? I mean, in the waters and in the sky? He knows every one of them. He made them. Do you know that God even knows when one bird falls? Did you know that? Those are all scriptures from the Bible. When a thousand birds fall, he does. But you know what I think is one of the best things? God knows you. And you and you and you and you and you and you and you. He knows us. He knows me. He knows when you stand up and when you sit down. Oh, yep, he knew that. He knows when you go and when you come. He knows everything. He knows when you're happy and everything's great, going well for you. And he knows when you're sad. He knows when you're afraid. He knows when you have a bruise. He knows when you have a tear. He knows when you won the game, right? He knows when you're first in line. He knows when you're last in line. He knows when you lose the game too, because God knows everything. He knows everything. He knows when you forgive somebody, and he knows when you're mad. He knows when you decide to give God more time. He knows when you open your Bible. He knows when you pray, because you're praying and talking to him. God knows everything. And I have a Bible verse that I'm going to teach you. It's pretty short, okay? Pastor Mike's going to talk more about it. But it's found in Psalms 139:1. So you say Psalms 139:1. Okay, let's do that again. Psalms 139:1. Oh God, you have searched me. And you know me. That's what we stand on, God's word. He tells us, he searched us, he knows us. Think we can say it again? Psalms 139:1. Oh God, you have searched me and you know me. Let's just say that part. Oh God, you have searched me. Oh God, you have searched me and you know me. And you know me. That is wonderful. And that's something to remember. And that's the best thing, to remember God knows everything. And he knows you and he loves you very much. All right? Let's pray. Fold your hands. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. God, we're so grateful to be here. We thank you for all these awesome boys and girls. We thank you, Lord, that you know everything about everything. And you know us, each one of us. You love each one of us. Help us to spend more time with you this week, even this day, thinking about you, praying to you, talking to you, praying for others, reading the Bible, telling our parents what we learned in Sunday school. All of these things, Lord, we thank you for, and we ask you to help us. And I ask you to bless these boys and girls wherever they go this week. You help them to share love to other kids and other people and to tell them about Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, the papers are over on this side this time.
Okay, thank you, Anne. We're going to be in Psalm 139 this morning. In just a moment, as the kids go back to their seats. Thank God for the children. They are a blessing. Psalm 127 says they are like arrows in the hands of a warrior, sharp arrows in the hands of a warrior. Let's bow our heads in prayer first, please. Heavenly Father, thank you now for your word. Your word is our very life. Your word guides and directs us. It is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our paths. Psalms 19 so wonderfully says, oh, how I love your law, Lord. It is sweeter than honey to my taste. And so it is. As we sit and we hear it together here this morning, and as we read it at home with our families or one-on-one, your word is so wonderful. I ask for you to speak through me this morning by your Spirit to those gathered here. Open the eyes of our understanding to see your word, to understand it, to live it each and every day. And I thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 139, for those visiting, we've been in Hebrews 11, but I just thought with baptism we'd take a break, and this psalm is so appropriate for baptism, so I'm going to read it, beginning in verse 1. O Lord, you have searched me. And you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. You hem me in behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, and the for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. If only you would slay the wicked, O God. Away from me, you bloodthirsty men. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord, and abhor those who rise up against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Amen. Psalm 139. We're just going to look really at the first six verses of this passage. But it speaks, as we know, how God knits these little ones together within the mother's womb, and how beautiful that is. It's truly amazing. But in these first six verses, we are seeing, as Anne was talking to the little ones about that, how much God knows us. God knows you. If you're visiting, we have the outline in the back insert of your bulletin. If you want to follow along in there, you sure can. God knows you is that letter A, where we're going to start out. And in these six verses, he's going to show us a different picture of ourselves. It's like God, from God's viewpoint, looking down upon us, showing us how intimately he knows us. It's very, very incredible. It should give us hope when so much of the world seems out of control. As I mentioned in one of the prayers here, there is one who is in control. You say, well, if God is in control, why is the world such a mess? Good question, I suppose. The world is in such a mess because there is a devil. His name is Satan, and he comes to steal and kill and destroy. And we live in a fallen world. Since the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve ate of that fruit they were not supposed to eat, and sin came in, and the fall of man, as we call it, and that is why the world is as it is, plain and simple. But God is in control. He sees it all. He has the perfect plan for the return of his Son, Jesus Christ, which is going to happen at the exact time, and we better be ready for that moment. So that is a whole nother sermon. He's in control. So there, in these six verses here, he uses seven different Hebrew words. That was the original language. Seven different words in these six verses to tell us how he knows us. I think that's pretty amazing. We've looked at this once before, our congregation, a while back, but I wanted to just go through this part of it again. If you think of yourself as an onion, whether you like onions or not, you know, onions have all these layers, and you just can sort of peel them back one by one, can't you, to get to the very core or center of that onion. So think about these seven words as God knows us inside and out. He's just peeling back the layers. We think we can hide things from him, but we cannot. He knows us. So the first one, as Ann worked with the kids there, verse 1, O Lord, you have searched me. You have searched me. So that word in the Hebrew, it means to examine intimately. to examine intimately. Now, we, as mankind has developed, as medical science has developed so incredibly in the last 100 years, for sure, they can go way down deep with their pictures and all everything into the inner parts of our physical bodies, can't they? Yeah. They start mostly with blood work, right? How many years? Way back in Leviticus. 2,000 years back to Jesus. 2,000 more years back to Abraham. And God said 4,000 years ago to the people, guess what? The life is in the blood. Took man almost 4,000 years to figure all that out. But they did. But as much as man knows about the human body, there are still so many mysteries that they don't understand. The life is in the blood, so they do the blood work. Let's see how that looks. You go for your physical, right? Oh, something's a little bit off here, it seems. I think we need to go further. Now, you got to come back for this kind of test or that kind of test. And maybe they say, we need to do an x-ray. Well, you know, the x-ray didn't quite show enough. Let's do a CT scan. Go a little deeper. Well, you know what? You got to come back another time because we got to go deeper. Let's do an MRI. And deep they go. And then we got the wonderful colonoscopies for those of you that are 50 and above. They go in from bottom up, right? And then they got the coming down from the top down, the endoscopy, to try and see what's all going on. And then maybe they open you up to do some kind of a surgery. But they still cannot get to the soul or the spirit of man. They cannot do that. Only God, by the Holy Spirit, can search our inward parts, our innermost being, and even the thoughts of the mind. You know, physical things are broken bones generally are pretty easy to set, right? Or put a plate in or whatever all they do. But when it comes, if there's any of you who have or do struggle with depression and things like that, those things are not such an easy fix, are they? They can be very, very difficult. If you've ever experienced it, you know full well. It's not just, oh, here's a pill, we'll see you. No, be nice. But God searches to examine us intimately. He knows whether you know him personally or not. He knows everything about you. Oh, Lord, you have searched me. And at the end of this psalm, David, who wrote it, even says to the Lord in those last two verses, search me, O God, I'm asking you to do this. Search me and know my heart. Test me, know my anxious thoughts. And here's a pretty bold prayer. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. We need to ask God that. Lord, if there's things I'm doing that are displeasing to you, a lot of times we know that anyway, but sometimes maybe we don't. Show me. Okay, if he shows us, then what are we going to do? We're going to do something about it? We're going to ignore it? Hopefully we do something about it. All right, second one. And you know me. Number one, oh Lord, you have searched me. Second, you know me. That word know is used 3 times in the next couple verses. The first word, meaning of it, is observation. Second, your blank is care. Third, as it's written, is recognition. So he observes us always. 3 times. First one, you know me. Verse 2, what does he say? You know when I sit and when I rise. I like the amplified there. It says, you know my entire life, everything I do. Verse 4, the third time we see that word know, before a word is ever on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. Still amplified says, even when it's still unspoken. Whew. Now how about, let's think in our human relationships, friendships, marriages, maybe dating. There's times where we think, Let's say the dating, all right, that part. As a man, I would think, boy, if she ever knew that about me, would she love me? Would she stay with me? And we would most likely never share what that could be. Just last week in confirmation class, we were in Proverbs, I guess, with the eighth grade group, talking about some of this in that passage. And one of the eighth graders said, "Pastor Mike, what's the worst sin you've ever done?" I said, "I'm not telling you." I said, "What's the worst sin you've ever done?" "I'm not telling you." But okay, we're even then, right? That was about the first time I was asked that in confirmation class. Never know what they're going to come up with in there. No, we think if about people, boy, if they knew that about me, would they even care to be my friend? You know what? God knows it all, and He wants to be your friend. He loves you incredibly. He knows it all, whether you've told Him or not in confession. Hopefully you have. If there are those things that you would never want anybody to know, hopefully you have confessed it to the Lord and said, "God, this is what I have done. I am so ashamed of it. This is it. Name it. I ask you to forgive me." And does He? Yes, He does. Number three, you perceive my thoughts from afar. Perceive, what does that mean? That means to discern, to consider diligently, and to know. This part again, so let's talk about our thoughts. Right? He says, "He perceives my thoughts from afar." One translation, it says, even this, "God, you understand my thoughts long before they ever come floating into my head." Now, there's a whole, I would think, for all of us in here, there's a whole lot of thoughts that fly through this brain that we would never speak out of our mouth. Hopefully. Now, sometimes, sometimes I've seen it in the very, very elderly where sometimes we say they've just lost their filter, right? There is no filter. Whatever's coming through here is coming out here. Doesn't matter. Who's around? I can think of a funeral I did some years back. The grandma was still living. She was up there, and I'm guessing it was probably her husband's funeral, but there were grandchildren here. Well, in the social hall before the service started, the family was waiting. Some of the granddaughters or great-granddaughters were wearing some outfits that the great-grandma thought were very inappropriate for the day. And so she just says to one of her granddaughters sitting by her, so this had to be great-granddaughter, as these girls were walking by, loudly, "Can you believe they're wearing that at this funeral today?" I just thought, no filter, that's all right. So you perceive my thoughts from afar, he says. Thoughts come. Okay, that doesn't mean we have to speak them out. I often say, yeah, thoughts come. The New Testament says that we are to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. If it's not a good thought, you've got to just say, "In the name of Jesus, I cast that thought out of my mind." All right, does that mean it just instantly goes? Sometimes, oftentimes it's right back. One of our professors in seminary said this. He said, "You know, it's like this. You cannot keep a bird from flying over your head, but you sure can keep a bird from building a nest on your head." What's that mean regarding your thought life? Yeah, thoughts are going to come. All kinds of crazy ones, all kinds of good ones. If you're going to take those bad thoughts and dwell on it, think on it, I'd like to do that if I had the chance. You're letting that nest be built upon your head, okay? Those thoughts can be diligent. The devil, the battlefield that he works against this one way is in our mind, and he is very persistent in all of that. We have a lamp outside the front door of the parsonage there, and I'm telling you, we always have a wind chime hanging outside that front door, because if we don't, I can guarantee you there's going to be a robin there in the spring wanting to build his, her nest on the inside part of that lantern, right outside the front door, because it's happened before. I go out there, knock it down in the morning, end of the day, there it all is again. I'm like, how do they build that thing so fast? Knock it down, next day it's back. Put up the wind chime, they don't like that. They do not like the noise. Problem solved. So, our thoughts, we renew our minds with God's word. That's why we have to be in it. Number four here, you discern my going out and my lying down. To discern means to scrutinize, to winnow, or to scatter, talking about the threshing of grain, that word, to winnow in there. But to scrutinize, what's that? That means to pay close attention to the minute details. I think, to me, that's getting into our motives. God knows our motives. Why are we doing this? Why are we doing that? Is it to get attention? Look at me! Woo! Is it to get back at somebody? Is it there's all kinds of crazy motives? He discerns those things in our lives. There's a movie, it's a Christian movie called Play the Flute. I was going to go into that, but for time's sake, I'm not going to. Yeah, we have it in our library. It should be, right? I think so. It's about a church youth group and all, and you'll see when I talk about motives, there's something in there about that if you want to check it out. It's very good. He discerns our going in and our lying down. Let's go to number five. You are familiar with all my ways. How about that? Amplified says, you are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Psalm 5:21, listen to this. For a man's ways are in full view of the Lord, and he examines all his paths. There's nothing that we can hide from him. We might be able to hide from people, might be able to hide from our parents, some stuff. Not so often. You hem me in. Let me back up. You are familiar with all my ways. Kids, I had to laugh here. I heard this account recently. This was an adult who used to be in high school. And this high school girl was going to go out with her friends, which was okay. The dad had said yes. And so they had a basket of clothing that they had this daughter they were supposed to take to Goodwill down in Yankton. And so what first started out, the daughter, the dad saw there was a beer bottle in the car. So he said, before you go, hand it over. Oh, sorry, Dad, sorry. So they're getting in the car, the clothes basket is in the back seat, and he says, before you go, let's just look in that clothes basket in the back seat. There's a whole bunch of beer bottles in that clothes basket in the back seat. He said, get in the house right now and bring that with you. Sits one down and opens it and says, drink it right here. That was his solution to the deal. Well, she bawled and bawled and bawled and bawled and never did drink it. But a very important lesson was learned that day. He knows. He's familiar with all of our ways. Number six, you hem me in, behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Wow. To hem me in, that means to confine. This is talking about God's protection upon you. I love that. He knows you so well. His hand of protection, you have laid your hand upon me. The one translation, it says, you are all around me. You are in front of me. You are in back of me. You laid your hand upon me. That, in one way, especially in the Old Testament, is the hand of blessing, protection that God lays upon us. Other ways, that hand, what? Think of yourself as a parent, these young kids. The hand is a hand to guide, right? Maybe you're going somewhere in a store or in Sioux Falls and you're just guiding those little ones with your hands. No, this way, gently. Maybe there's some times where it's like, no! And your hand is firmly on them and you're pulling them back, right? And God does all of that with us. He guides us gently along as we listen. There are times where it is a very firm, no. I said no. According to his will and his word. Number 7, the last one. Such knowledge, this David saying, this is incredible. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. That knowledge is speaking of awareness, God's awareness over us and in our lives. Such infinite knowledge. He's like, this is so overwhelming. God, what can I do? What can I do to hide from you? Nothing. He knows it all. Now, David sinned greatly, didn't he? God also forgave him greatly. He went, remember, he was supposed to be out with his men at war, and he was up on the rooftop of the palace looking over the city. There he sees Bathsheba taking a bath. Send for that young lady. And we know what happens. I think most of you do. She gets pregnant, right? But God forgave. He forgave and he used him mightily. When I think of Kaylee and Ty, I just think of God's mercy. When I think of Ty about 2 or 3 years ago, whatever what it was 3 years ago, I'm trying to look at the family for a nod, when that incident happened, God's mercy is incredible. I'm telling you, there was so much prayer at that time. In Menno, in Freeman, both schools. I know I saw a picture at Menno School. Most all the high school after lunch one day was in a massive circle, hands held, praying for Ty Balvin on that day. I'm sure Freeman too. There was a day, I don't know, a day or a week after that, whatever it was, I was asked if I'd come out to the bean field out here north east of Menno, wherever it was. And there were going to be a bunch of high schoolers out there for prayer for Ty. And they said, when you get out there, we'll shut the combines down and we'll all come out on the gravel road. And there we stood as he was unresponsive. And there was a day when Ann and I went to the hospital in Sioux Falls when he was unresponsive, prayed over him, laying hands upon him. Is God's mercy incredible? It is. Absolutely incredible. Things happen. None of us are perfect. Yes, do we encourage, and I preach all the time, wait till marriage. Okay, things happen. So we support them in the process. We support them with where they're at. That's why I said to Kaylee, thank you for choosing life. Praise the Lord. And God has great plans for that little boy. He truly does. How'd I get on that? Oh, yes. David's fear of total exposure. Total exposure. He knows it all. And he loves us incredibly. The last, he said, so where can I go? God, where can I go from your spirit? The answer is nowhere. Where can I flee from your presence? The answer is nowhere. He said, if I go to the heavens, you're there. If I go to the depths, you're there. And on the passage goes. God knows your fears. He knows your thoughts, your motives, your dreams, your frustrations. He knows it all. And He is for you, and He is with you. So we rest in Him. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Your knowledge is far beyond our comprehension. Lord, if we think we're hiding from you, forgive us. If we have walls built up for whatever reason, maybe it's hurts and pains, maybe it's times where we thought you failed us, maybe it's times, situations where we thought you let us down, Father, break through those walls that we have put up, I pray. And just overwhelm us with your love and your presence in a very tangible way, that you would break us down, that we would realize you are the giver of life, Jesus, that you are the way to heaven and you are the only way to heaven. There is no other. Thank you for speaking that to our hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our closing hymn is 575. This is called Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, and this comes from Deuteronomy, actually chapter 33, when Moses pronounced a blessing on the tribe of Asher, which was one of the 12 tribes of Israel. And this, I want to read this and then we'll sing. He says, "There is no one like the God of Israel who rides the heavens to help you, and in his excellency on the clouds. The eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms." Let's stand and we'll sing this hymn. Please receive the benediction. And now may the Lord go with you. May He go ahead of you to guide you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you His peace. Amen. Now we sing one more song, God Bless America. We sing every Sunday as a prayer for our nation. So let's sing that now.
America,
be seated. Thank you, Cindy, for the beautiful music today. Someone will come to usher out the congregation here. Have a wonderful day.